Welcome everyone to the first episode of Magma Ragers. After some technical issues, we are back now for
Sweet.
hopefully for reals this time. With me, I'm Dib, and with me I've got Zaymok and Pandemonia. And first of all, we're gonna start talking about the nerfs, which we spoke about at length before the technical issues. The nerfs are small time buccaneers, as you can see here, is being nerfed to a 1/1 with a +2 attack buff if you have a weapon equipped, and Spirit Claws is being nerfed to cost 2 mana now instead of 1 mana previously. So let's start off with Pandemonia. What do you think overall about what this change is going to do to affect the meta?
So yeah, like I was saying earlier, it makes small time buccaneer a lot easier to deal because a lot of hero powers can deal with it. You know, mage, a druid, and your rogue can now actually kill it with the hero power. And you know, instead of, especially from arena mage perspective, you don't have to waste an arcane blast or frostbolt on it. I mean, like you're mentioning, who was it in the European prelims who coined
I was actually
kill?
Pavol in the semi-final
Was it?
against, I think it was against Green Sheep, yeah. He actually had to coin his Frostbolt on turn one
I mean,
against his opponent.
that is not a
That's
play you
not
want to
something
be
you ever
doing.
want to do. Yeah. And if he
Can you
didn't have
imagine?
Frostbolt, I guarantee you he would have coined Ping on the Buccaneer, because that's how bad it is. Like, he would have had to deal with it the next turn. And he coined Ping,
There was
and
a
then the
lot of
next turn.
talk on Twitter afterwards about whether that was actually correct, but that's another story.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not
Yeah.
going to say it
But
was wrong.
the point is, it as it is, it requires a lot more
The 1 minute
resources.
threat.
Yeah.
Yeah, but even
That's
to
it.
have to consider that, like, a
Yeah.
coin Ping on a one drop.
Yeah.
What the hell? You never should have to do that. There should be no metagame where one drops are that powerful that you have to coin Ping.
Yeah.
Like, the only time I've
Yeah.
ever seen it done was like free Ping against
Undertaker.
Zeus. Okay, I wasn't
Yeah,
even gonna say
Undertaker,
that. As I'm
Undertaker,
looking at the scene, I
Undertaker.
wasn't even gonna
Oh,
pronounce
yes,
spawn another thing.
Undertaker. Yeah,
Yeah.
that was also, yeah,
Okay, but
Undertaker.
let's be fair. This was no Undertaker. Like, Buccaneer was powerful, but
No
no
Undertaker.
Undertaker.
No, it wasn't. No, Undertaker was 10 times worse.
Yeah. But anyway, before we go into a completely different discussion, okay, so what decks do you think then are going to be most prevalent post the nerf, Pandemonia?
I think mid-range shaman, it's going to become more dominant than it already is. I think pirate warrior will still be very popular. So between the nerf and the new expansion, I don't think the meta is going to shift as much as we would like it to. I mean, maybe people might knee-jerk reaction within the first few days and try crazy things again. But I think within a few days, pirate warrior will still be a thing. Aggro shaman just without the pirates now will still be a deck. Mid-range shaman will still be a deck. Like, I don't think it's going to change things that much. It just means you're not going to lose to ridiculous starts from pirate warrior, of turn one buccaneer, turn two take a ton of damage to the face.
Yeah.
Do you not think that the amount of pirate shaman will decrease in pirate rogue? Because I don't
Yeah.
know, they don't really have the support that the warrior has. The warrior has like Nzosvet Mace still, you know, and it's still got the Bloodsail Corsair. But I don't know, I don't feel, especially with Spirit Claws, which is the card that we're about to talk about. I really don't think that the pirate shaman especially will, that
Yeah,
pirate will
definitely. Yeah,
CK
that's
and
what I was
shaman.
saying. As I was saying, I
Yeah,
think it's
so
going to go
mid-range
more
will
just traditional
increase.
aggro.
Mid-range will increase, but not only because not only because like the meta will slow down a bit, which is obviously a bit better for mid range, but also just because the aggro will be less viable now, and so that'll make the mid range inherently better if you
Yeah.
want to play the aggressive shaman. I mean, let's face it,
And
mid
also
range
it's
shaman
better
still.
against the Reno locks. I mean, the different Reno decks as well. Mid-range
It's
Shaman has a
debatable.
lot more versatility. I don't know, but the Jade with the Jade, a lot of the ones with the Jade package, I think you can easily just outvalue
Yeah, you can, and
the
just
Reno
constant threats.
decks.
That's one of the reasons why Jade Druid is just like so ridiculously good against control. It's just because you've just got endless threats in theory.
Exactly.
But
You spend 1 minute to spawn an 8/8.
yeah, I mean the mid-range shaman actually against control decks has a lot of resource management. You have to know exactly when to play your Jade cards. A lot of players are playing Bloodlust now, which is also really strong, makes those worthless totems really powerful. 21 damage from that, seemingly out of nowhere, is really good.
Especially
And
against the
also.
Reno lock.
Yeah, especially against the
Exactly,
Arena
yeah.
lock. And also something that I've been doing a lot is, because I was playing a bit of Control Warrior actually recently in the past few days, and when I see Mana Tide come down from the Jade shamans, you almost face with the decision, do I want to kill the Manatide or not? And often, if you don't kill the Manatide, you can actually fatigue them. And one of the ways the Jade Shamans lose is just because they can't spawn the Jades. It's a really difficult matchup, actually. You know, it's definitely not the hardest deck in the game to play, but it's also a lot more difficult than just, you know, throwing Jades down. It's I don't know. In my opinion, at least, there's a lot of resource management with that deck.
Control War is a horrible... It struggles against Jade decks as well, because you have to now constantly say, okay, my removal, do I need to kill a Manatard? Do I need to kill this Jade that basically they got for free?
I mean, Bran is probably the MVP in that matchup, right? Bran for the Jade.
Well, yeah, I mean, Bran is pretty much the MVP for the matchup for most of the mid-range Jade Shaman against control decks. I mean, it's either Bran or Bloodlust now that they're actually playing Bloodlust. Either you need to force them to commit all their removal, and then you can do your Bran reload, or you need to just, like, tickle them with totems and then Bloodlust them to leave them.
What a great
tickle them putting with that. Totems. I love that one, yeah.
Okay, so... what do you think, like, overall, the decks that are going to be most prevalent, Zaymok, after the...
Don't they go hand in hand, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, we can. Yeah, we can talk about...
Firstly, like, things to note after the Buccaneer nerf comes in. Twilight Flamecaller for Reno Mage. I'm pretty sure that's going to be a thing. Ravaging Ghoul, we might see teched into some Pirate Warriors. Control Warrior will get better with the Revenge and the Ravaging Ghoul. Now just a really clean removal on turn 2 with the Revenge. Coin Ravaging Ghoul becomes really strong. Just Ravaging Ghoul on 3 is a lot better than it was. And you don't even have... You're seeing less resources used to clear these early game minions, like the Coin Fastball that we talked about earlier, something that should never be happening. Now we get to see Coin Ping, for example. So I think the meta will definitely slow down. Pirate Warrior probably will... I think the popularity will decrease a bit, but it won't be eliminated. It's not like Pirate Warrior is not going to be a thing anymore. I think it'll definitely still be a thing. The Pirate Package, in my opinion, will be removed from Shaman almost entirely, and we'll get into that a little bit more why. We'll get into that a little bit more as to why that's happening. And it's also just a lot to do with Spirit Claws. And I also think the Pirate Package will probably be removed from Miracle Rogue. I'm almost certain about that.
Yeah.
And I've got a lot of opinions on that, but I'm not going to get into that now. And I'm not sure how Aggro Rogue is going to fare after, because to be honest, it's been quite a really good card in Aggro Rogue.
One of
the reasons that's keeping the deck so hard.
I actually think that Miracle Rogue as a whole is actually one of the biggest benefiters from this, even though it was a Buccaneer class, and a lot of people will look at Hunter and go, okay, is Hunter going to be viable now that maybe not as many Buccaneers are running around to crush all their minions? You know, you can now play Kindly Grandmother, and kind of it deals with the Buccaneer in a way, right? They need to trade the patches or trade as well. So that they don't have that, like, favorable trade on the first part of the Kindly Grandmother. But I think the Rogues are going to be quite happy not to have to play Buccaneer. It's quite a low-value card, so I think it's making Rogue stronger against a lot of the control decks. And one of the things that I think Aggro Rogue's not even going to suffer that much from it. Aggro Rogue can also replace the Pirate Packages with the Pirate Package with maybe the Finger Murloc Package. And it can also possibly start running Saps, because that's one of the biggest weaknesses of the Aggro Rogue, is that it has no Saps. No, like, none of the lists have any Saps. Pretty much. So
you just go all face and hope for the best.
Yeah, so against some of the, like, Druid decks and stuff, we might see seeing more. I think it's going to start needing Sap a lot more. So I think we're probably going to see 2 Saps come back into the deck, which is actually going to help that deck against the mid-range decks as well. So I think Rogue as a whole is actually going to benefit from this. Obviously, also, Miracle Rogue was really weak to aggro decks and had no nice way to deal with the Buccaneer except Backstab. And now they can deal with it with the weapon. And
of knives, yeah.
Yeah, and the double fan of knives that we'll likely see. And even Shiv cards really like Shiv, finished. Yeah.
Yeah. Freeze Mage is also going to get better.
When
the meta slows down, Druid will increase, Miracle Rogue will increase in popularity, Midrin Shaman will increase in popularity, and all of these decks are actually really weak to Freeze Mage, so we could see an increase in Freeze Mage, and this also means, and not only, this isn't only going to happen because Freeze Mage will increase, but it's kind of weird, with Miracle Rogue increasing and what's the other deck? Miracle Rogue increasing and with Pirate decks getting weaker, Control Royal might increase. Freeze Mage is going to increase because Druid and Miracle Rogue and Midrange Shaman are going to increase. And we're going to have this actually really... I think it's going to be a nice metagame. You know, every deck has a chance to win. It's going to be a bit Rock, Paper, Scissors at times, but...
I'm not convinced... Personally, I'm not convinced that the Freeze Mage can take on the Jade Druid decks, or the Jade decks specifically. I'm actually not convinced. I'm convinced it can take on Shaman, as long as you don't get the... So both of the two decks have big heals in them, which is the biggest problem right now. So yeah. Even if you're Alex, you need to have like a huge combo with the Thoris and Reduction to actually kill them. And I don't think that those decks are really going to give you that much time. I mean,
most Midrange Shamans aren't running Healing Wave. Most of them are just
Not Healing Wave, yeah, Jinyu. But Jinyu Bran, like, in that matchup, if you know you're playing against Freeze Mage, you don't play Bran.
Jinyu, yeah.
You always hold Jinyu for Bran. Or, like, hold them to play together.
Are we going to see cycle-heavy Freeze Mage, you know, try to get that OTK? I don't know, there's, like, different ways to build. Freeze Mage, semi-flexible.
Yeah, but I think the Freeze Mage will be under enough pressure that it's not going to get away with just... cycling in those decks. Those decks aren't that slow.
You know? I mean, this is all speculation. We'll see.
Yeah. But I'm a bit wary on Freeze Mage as much as I like the deck.
Same Dale. What are you trying to say?
Freeze Mage also tend to struggle a bit against like, some of the Reno decks, though, because even though you're trying to educate and, you know, you've always got to... You try Alex... You know, it's a case of you Alex versus Reno. You know, it's constantly... You can almost never set up a OTK from 30, though, unless you get crazy Chlorus.
Play Cobalt, play the Evolved Cobalt. It's no problem against Reno decks. Honestly, like if Reno Lock was was prevalent enough, Freeze Mage would be a thing. If Reno Lock was just that great. Because you can quite against slower decks, like the Reno decks are generally a bit slower. Okay. Things like Mountain Dine and Twilight Drake are annoying. But things like Mountain Giants and Twilight Drake, yeah, those are good against the Freeze Mage. But we even saw in the World Championships last year, actually, there was a Chinese player who bought Polymorph checked into his Freeze Mage list just to deal with the cards like Mountain Giant and that. But
okay, but I think we're going a bit off topic here on the Freeze Mage. Freeze Mage is very speculative, I think, as to whether it's going to be good or not.
I don't think the meta itself currently will shift that much. You know.
Yeah, I agree. I think it gets a bit better for Rogue and maybe a bit better for the Reno decks because they are not as likely to be completely crushed before they can Reno, basically. Yeah. I mean, they still have to draw the Reno, which is always the problem with Reno decks, but they're not as likely to be crushed before turn 6, which is what does sometimes happen when you get those double small-time Buccaneer openings or something crazy like that.
With Spirit Claws, because you'd have Spirit Claws, more time Buccaneer, you know, roll spell power.
Yeah, I get spit out of hand.
Okay, and then one of the other things from this post, moving on from the nerfs, is that they're going to be changing a bit how ranked works. In that here, they've said that they're going to have ranked floors at rank 10 and 5, which is very nice for a lot of the casual players. And 15, sorry. Which I think it'll improve. Some people will reach those ranks and then start playing more like casual decks and stuff, you know, because they don't mind like losing because they can't lose actual rank. So I think what that's going to do is it's going to create like a weird meta around ranks 15, 10, and 5. Where if you're at that rank, you're going to start seeing weird decks, and then when you start getting closer to the next floor, it's like try hard again, and then like. Starts
like
getting weird again.
I think it's going to create sort of an interesting micro meta because a lot of people sometimes, you know, reach rank 5 and then get rank anxiety and don't play. Whereas now, you know, they made it to rank 5 with Inner Fire Priest and, you know, they'll continue playing it past rank 5 now because the lowest they can drop to is rank 5.
It's 5, yeah.
You know, yeah. I think people have heard seen my story of how I took Rogue to get my last wins from rank 2
to
rank
5 to 16. Oh yeah, to 15.
Wow.
Just to get my final ranked wins.
I mean, your winner must have been shocking though. The Pandemonium.
you'll get it right eventually.
Eventually.
Yeah, okay.
So, I think it's a good thing for the game.
Yeah.
I think they were also chatting about...
Needed.
They were, I think, like there. I know Ben Brody. They were speaking about even introducing bigger changes to rank because they realized sort of how dull and sort of how there's no real major motivation for players to reach legend or high level legend. You know, besides the HCT points. You know, for
which a lot of people are just like
Like, oh, you know, legend, cool. Okay, card back. Okay, I'm legend.
I mean, they did add the dust and golden card rewards to at least reach rank 5.
Oh, yeah, extra golden common.
But I mean, I think it does matter to play. Some players still building their collections in that they can dust those golden cards to craft other cards they need. But I agree,
okay, in terms of
to the majority of players and the type of players, yeah, the type of players that are like vocal on Reddit, you know, like complaining about the ladder meta, basically, I think this might help a bit in at least making the ladder meta more interesting around these like pockets. And yeah, I think it's good. To me, it's good that it at least means they're thinking about ladder changes. I just hope that this is not the last of the ladder changes that we see. I think it's a good indicator that they realize that there's something wrong, but it's, you know, it's a good start, let's say that.
They've been a lot more vocal recently on like Twitter and on social media, just in general on Facebook and that, just talking about like what they're doing.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. Which is good.
I think people in like the thing is at the end of the day, people just want to know that something is being looked at and done, even if it's not immediate.
Yeah.
They just want to know that, you know, their concerns have been noted, whereas the silence doesn't show you either way.
And basically the
kind of like, we're seeing this problem, but we're just ignoring it because we don't have to deal with it.
Yeah, exactly. We hope it goes away by itself.
Yeah, and basically the Overwatch team are also making them look bad because they're always churning out these developer insights. And I think there's a big crossover between people that play Overwatch and Hearthstone. So I think that that creates a lot of like annoyance from Hearthstone players. Yeah, but specifically, you know, lots of people tend to play a lot of Blizzard games. Like if you play one Blizzard game, you probably play other Blizzard games. So I think then, you know, that creates a lot of like, well, you know, this team at Blizzard are doing it, the developer insights and stuff so much better. Why aren't Team 5? So I think that's also put a lot of pressure on them, to be honest.
So do you honestly think there's a lot of sort of, it's like a sort of a...
I don't think there's a rivalry.
I don't think there's a rivalry. No, I'm not saying there's a rivalry at all. I'm saying that player perception has changed. You know, they're starting to expect more from Blizzard.
Yes, exactly.
And now they're getting...
Like, you're the player, you're spending hundreds of, well, I'm going to say dollars, well, we're like spending thousands of rounds on this game, you know what I mean? Like, we expect something in return for you to play, right?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, more feedback, you know, you've invested in this game, like, people care about it, I have to care about the game, you know? I'm sure you guys too. Like, we want the game to improve, so people are vocal about it, and you want to see them kind of acknowledging our voice, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's the thing, you know, just them saying, we're looking at it, you know, like they were, I mean, like, what's it? Was it Dina Yellow who posted about they were testing arena changes with the changing percentage spells? They were trying to increase the rate, which spells you could pick spells.
Yeah,
for
I saw
arena.
That post.
Yeah, there was some post about that.
But basically, they're posting a lot of their sort of thought processes, which is good.
Yeah, I think that was a slightly older one. And they're also doing.
Could tell them off.
They're also doing a stream coming up tomorrow. It looks like a Developer Insights Q&A stream.
That's seven. Those usually start at 8 o'clock.
Yeah, I'm not sure what time it is. Anyway, so yeah, I think that's all there really is to say regarding the nerfs. Unless you guys have any last thoughts on the
cut
nerfs. I said I think that's all there.
You know,
yeah.
Just like hopefully the meta slows down. You know, as a control player, one can live in dream. You know that I can play. You know,
what's happening?
All my expenses. I can play my.
Did we lose someone? Did I mute myself?
I don't know, but. It seems fine for me.
Can
you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yep. Hopefully I can play in Zoth for like, the last bit. I can play in Zoth with
Kane. Okay, it looks like we lost Zaymok. I think he had some trouble hearing us. But yeah, personally, I don't really mind if the meta starts becoming a bit more control, because that's probably going to mean Rogue becomes better. And I'm happy to play Rogue versus your control decks. Bring it. I even can finally play Malygos Rogue again. No, yeah, Control Warrior is the only one that I don't want to play Malygos Rogue against, because I can go above 30 HP. I will abuse Thorison until he rotates out.
Control Warrior, I'll miss Justicar.
Yeah.
And Justicar Elise.
Yeah.
I think Zaymok has beat himself.
Yeah, I'm not sure. We can't really hear him on TS, but it looks like he's trying to talk, and his
audio video
is not going to. There we go.
My bad. At last.
Okay, so okay, so I think we can move on now to the next point, the next topic, which is going to be the rotation changes and the Year of the Mammoth stuff that they announced. So this year, yeah. So this year we're moving out of the Year of the Kraken and we're moving into the Year of the Mammoth. And there's been a lot of information.
What does this mean? Tell us.
There's been a lot of information surrounding this. So
what does the rotation mean?
The rotation. So the rotation basically means that they're going to be releasing. Well, one of the major things they announced now is that they're not going to be releasing adventures anymore. That they're just going to be doing 130 plus, I imagine, card expansions, and three of them a year essentially. So when the next expansion is released, the previous expansions being, or the previous card sets being TGT or the Grand Tournament, League of Explorers, and Blackrock Mountain are going to be rotating out of standard, and they're going to become wild only. And they've said that there's going to be some more wild support, but we'll get to that a bit later. So those are the cards that are going to be going out just based purely on the rotation factor. And then we're going to see, obviously, the new cards that they release in the latest expansion, which we expect to probably be the Lost Secrets of Un'Goro or something something similar to that based on the leaks.
Yeah.
So just to clarify for anyone who doesn't know, it's going to be TGT, Blackrock Mountain, and LOE all going to be rotating out because it's the expansions from the last 2 years that are staying in.
Yeah, the expansions from 2015 that are going out.
Yeah.
And 2016 and 2017 will be the cards that are allowed in standard, basically.
So even though I know, you know, you can't really speculate on what decks are going to be things because you don't know the card, but I think we can say is that, like, dragon decks almost, like, unless they get massive support.
Yes, they did.
Because they're dead because Blackrock Mountain. And I think even TGT had quite a lot of good dragon support.
The Twilight Guardian.
Twilight Guardian, Blackwing Corruptor, your Twilight Whelp, your Wormless Agent. Well, Dragon Priest, rip.
Yeah, Dragon Priest is pretty ripperino right now. Like,
yeah,
but, and there's a lot of, like, the combo decks that are going to suffer from losing Thorison as well. But I think it's a bit difficult to speculate because they could well print new dragons to replace them. I mean, I don't think it's too off-theme to print dragons for Un'Goro. I mean, it's mostly like a dinosaur-y themed area. But hell, Blizzard could
dinosaurs,
print some dragons.
Dragons.
Yeah, dinosaurs classically have been beasts in Hearthstone. So that could be a bit... could definitely spot mark the return of Hunter if there's a lot of, like, beast synergy. Hunter and maybe some crazy beast druid.
Yeah.
But I'm not looking forward
feels
to
like it. They kind of gave dragons a last hurrah with the latest expansion, you know?
Yeah.
Like, oh, we'll give you Draconoid Operative, Dragonfire Potion, you know, all these dragon cards.
I mean, it does feel like those are actually indicators that they might be printing more dragon cards because it's really weird to print a card when you know that the other cards that support it are going out and that it's going to be, like, pretty much a dead card afterwards. I don't think that dragon decks are going to be as strong, but I think that they might still exist to a certain extent.
It's still playable because, I mean, Operative is still strong. I mean, if you're running a late-game dragon, whether you're running Ysera, I mean, Ysera is still in the set, Alexstrasza, you know. I think Operative is still good, enough to...
Yeah, but you just won this
like dragon package.
Dragon Trident Whelp.
No.
Guardian is huge.
No, definitely, but what I'm saying is I think you might, you know, obviously this is all speculation, but you might move away from sort of a dragon-centric deck to a, let's say, mid-range or priest control with a dragon package in it.
Dragon Paladin might actually... Because Dragon Paladin has the, what's that, 3-mana, 2/3 that summons the 1/1s if you're holding a dragon. Oh, no, but they're also losing the dragon cards.
Consort.
Yeah, they're losing consort.
But I think the problem with early dragon cards is that you need to have a high density of dragons in order to have a likelihood to activate them. So as Pandemonia is saying, I think that cards like Draconoid Operative might well still be viable because they come down a bit later in the game and you don't have to play them on curve. Obviously, playing it on curve is really powerful, but if you don't play it on curve, it still does draw you a card, which is obviously very important in a lot of the control matchups.
I mean, this obviously ties in a little bit with discussion. The fact that Azure Drake is no longer in standard as well hurts those dragon decks even more.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's something we'll be getting to just now, but yeah, that is also a big thing.
I was like, fuck. How is Azure Drake no longer in standard? What are you talking about? Oh my god. Jeez.
Well, right. Apparently this comes as news to Zaymok. But there's also some cards moving to the Hall of Fame. So I think that's a pretty good time to talk about that now. So the cards moving to Hall of Fame are Ice Lance, Conceal, Azure Drake, Sylvanas, and Ragnaros. So the Hall of Fame... Oh yeah, and Power Overwhelming, yeah. Sorry, so Hall of Fame basically means that they're going to essentially be wild-only cards. Even though these are all classic cards, Blizzard have basically decided that they are too restrictive to their design space, or that they're basically just sick of seeing decks like Freeze Mage, and they decided that they want to nerf the... Or they want to remove the cards from Standard this while still keeping the decks.
He's like, they hate Freeze Mage and they hate Rogue. I'm leaving Hearthstone forever. I'm done.
What I hear is they hate combo, and they keep saying that they hate combo. And that annoys me. Yeah, because, but I mean, the problem last time they tried to diversify Rogue, they gave Rogue nothing. They were like, oh, let's nerf Blade Flurry so it's not all oil Rogue. Oh, wait, then Rogue was like dead for a bit.
They tried to give it the Death Raptor, they tried to give it Unearthed Raptor, and they tried to make Death Raptor all Rogue a thing.
No, they're trying to make Thief Rogue a thing, that's what they're trying to do.
I mean, the new thing, Steely cards they printed, like Shaku and Swashburglar are okay, but like Burgle is just rubbish.
Yeah, it's okay, but it's still not something you actually want to put in a deck.
Yeah, no, it's just rubbish. Burgle's just rubbish.
Oh, come on.
No, I'm saying like Shaku.
Oh, yeah, no, Shaku's pretty good, though. It's like a decentish body, and it's like a threat on board. It has like the like, kind of like super taunt because they really want to remove it. So it gets your opponent to expend resources, and it gains you resources. It's like cards like Burgle and Swashburglar don't really force your opponent to do anything.
No love for the Ethereal Peddler, you know. Come on.
I don't think...
The Peddler Burgle deck, come on.
Okay, so, I mean, I was playing some Aggro Rogue earlier today, and I did have as many Warlock cards in my hand as Rogue cards, but even then, I don't think I'd really want to play the Ethereal Peddler, because sometimes, like, let's say 60% of the cards you get are playable. Like, I got Dark Bargain. I'm never playing Dark Bargain, unless it's, like, play Charge Minions, yeah, it's Dark terrible. Bargain to kill Taunt. Like... So there's a lot of cards sometimes that are kind of unplayable.
This is why you get Dark Bargain with Fist of Jiraxxus. You know,
Fail! That's genius! Oh my gosh.
I just always want Soulfire and Power Overwhelming, because I'm like, please give me more burst, please give me more burst against Warlocks.
Exactly.
Anyway, so so those cards are going to be rotating out. I mean, we can say that they definitely affect a lot of decks that have been staples, namely of course Freeze Mage and Miracle Rogue have kind of been around for a long time. Miracle Rogue obviously used to be a lot more powerful, they nerfed it, and then it kind of came back after Oil back Rogue died. Whispers. Yeah, in Whispers of All Gods when Oil Rogue was no longer a thing.
And then I think, Greg, you know, if you ask any like decent Hearthstone player, you know, what's a good 5 drop, I think, you know, in current days, you know, 80-90% of the answers are going to be, you know, Azure Drake. And I think, I don't think it's overpowered per se. I just think it's a case of because it's so solid all around. You know, everything from aggro decks to control decks are running it. They would, like you said, they want more versatility. You know, like I mean,
it's
if
just
I
like a standard 5 drop
that
like you always play, right? And
so
it's not going to be that anymore.
Well, there was a time when it wasn't playable. And that was when Piloted Shredder was a thing, because you couldn't play an Azure Drake on 5 into their Piloted Shredder that they just played the turn before. So, like, basically the only way to make... Yeah, the way to make Drake, like, unplayable would be to print, like, OP 4 drops, and I don't think they want to do that. So it's fine enough that they removed Drake.
Shredder was too strong, I think.
Yeah, Shredder was too strong, and so was Belcher. So...
Yeah.
Just a tad too strong.
Yeah, I mean, I think Shredder was a bit, but you see, at that time, you see, even your 5 drops, you had the choice between Azure Drake and Sludge Belcher in neutral, and then a lot of the other classes also had, you know, viable-ish 5 drops, whereas now, you know, you look at many, I think, you know, you've, Azure Drake is sort of... And
5 drops are kind of rubbish, and that's what Firelands Portal has taught me, is 5 drops suck.
yes. Yeah, Firelands Portal, and you get Starving Buzzard. Feels bad, man.
Oh,
Or that bomber thing. The 2 mana, the 5 mana 2/2 that deals 5 damage to an enemy minion and then 5 damage to you on death rattle. I've gotten that a few times. I'm just like, what? No. I lose now.
This
thanks.
This is why it's odd. I didn't expect this.
And it's the same thing with Sylvanas, I think. It's because it was sort of so powerful, it limited a lot of design space. And also, 6-drop Sylvanas. Whereas at least now, you might see my good old buddy Black Knight come back. I miss Black Knight.
If post-nerfs Druid becomes strong enough, we might see Black Knight because Ancient of Wars are going to be strong.
Black Knight and Cairn. Oh,
Cairn is definitely going to be, I think, one of the go-to 4-drops now.
4-drops?
Six drops.
You live in a good world where Cairn is a 4-drop.
Hey, Cairn's just a Chilwind Yeti with another Chilwind Yeti.
That's just like, no one cares about Chilwind Yeti when you can play Cairn. Like, what's the point, right?
No one cares about Chilwind Yeti now, anyway.
And I mean, Ken, you said, will be a good 6-drop, but it won't be your go-to 6-drop because there'll be other 6-drops with just as much versatility in different situations. I mean, theoretically, you know, you still have Sunwalker, which is actually not that bad as a 6-drop.
But I'm sure they'll be printing more cards, and they just don't want to have to, like, power creep these cards in order to actually make the new cards that they print playable. So I don't think we can really say what's going to be replacing them, because I'd expect Blizzard to print new cards in those drop positions. Whereas, you know,
I think the idea to be replaced with already existing cards?
No, not to a large extent. I think
them
that
actually replace them in terms of drop, in terms of the curve, but not replace them in terms of like functionality. You don't just want, because I think they're currently trying to avoid what has happened in Magic, where you're just reprinting the same card, you know, with slightly different stats and a slightly different name each year. And they want, or even the same stats, just a different name.
Shock.
Really?
Well, no. or even laser. Yeah, same name, same card. You know,
they do that all the time.
Card every year. Like Giant Crow, that's been printed in nearly
But it's like a whole thing about making it easier for players to learn. They're simple cards, like, and sometimes it's the right time. But anyway, let's not get off on the tangent of talking about Magic, because we're going to be here for a while then. And also, Zaymok will feel kind of left out. Yeah.
I know what a cantrip is. That's all I need. I know you need lands.
And you know that's where Miracle comes from, or at least the term.
Yep, Miracle. When you play a card straight off the top of your deck. Yeah.
Anyway. So I think.
And then Ragnaros, obviously.
Yeah, Ragnaros. I mean, after we saw Boom leave, pretty much it was my go-to, was basically like, okay, Boom is gone, now Ragnaros is playable. Because Ragnaros was not that great against Boom. Like, I mean, you can't play it right after Boom. If you hit the Boom bots, you could just lose your Rag to 2 Boom bots, basically.
You play in the place of Rag at the moment.
Well,
the thing is also is that
I don't
know, there's a lot of greedy stuff late game.
I don't really think you're going to replace Rag with anything that currently exists. Like, maybe Ronin for some mages. I think they want to start making those big drops more class-orientated as well. If you've seen what they've done like in recent times, is they've strayed away from printing more like staple, neutral, like big legendary minions. And most of the legendary minions they've printed are more like class-specific. Or at least the really big ones.
What, like Varian?
Yeah. Varian might be playable, but yeah.
Articles have saying about how, like, the problem is currently you'd have to do the test of, is your 8, 9, or 10 drop better than Rag?
Yeah.
And I mean, a lot of 9 drops don't even, you can't even really say a lot of 9 drops are better than Rag. And that's a problem when, you know, Rag is an 8 drop. You know,
like, would you play Medivh the Guardian over Rag and Reno Mage? Your answer should be yes, but
yes.
Rag is just so good. Why would you? No,
yeah,
Rag is
it's a toss-up. Very tough toss-up.
Yeah. It's not like an instant
Okay.
guess, I don't know.
Except,
yeah, but like Medivh is a good example of the big legendaries they're printing. Like Medivh and Kuhn the Forgotten King, sort of the big legendaries they're now printing in classes more than, you know.
Yeah.
And like Inkmaster Solia. It's also...
The RNG of Medivh versus the RNG of Rag. I don't know which RNG I love or hate more.
No, Rag is definitely worse. Medivh has counterplay. That just
flame
makes
strike with Medivh in play, And I got, what's it, a Dread Scale. I got the Hunter, 7 mana, 4/2.
Sick.
You could play Ooze, though. And, like, Harrison, and, I don't know.
It's more options to counter, yeah. Where's Rag? Oh, well, I mean, Big Game Hunter, rest in peace.
Oh, yes, still. You go play your Big Game Hunter, and stay at rank 26.
Hey, Big Game Hunter is playable in, like, Reno Lock, heavy control metas.
There's also Reno Lock this time. But it still doesn't feel good, good.
I mean, I think Onyxia might be one of the more playable, like, replacements, just out of the cards that they are right now. We also just might see a bit of the return of the old gods in Zoth decks and C'Thun decks becoming good against, good again. But, you know, Yogg can stay away.
Well, C'Thun is theoretically also quite good against control decks in terms of the amount of shit. Like, you can just kill people in, like, one turn with it.
Yeah.
And Zaymok will keep me funny.
Well, I mean, you can with the, control. Like, combo.
Yeah, like, but like away with combo, but, like, yeah. Outside of that, yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, I think I think they're tending to try and make legendaries more representative of classes, right? So, like, they're making more bigger legendaries than classes rather than... I mean, also, if we look at stuff like Rag Light Lord, those are becoming, like, the more... go-to legendaries. Like, they're trying not to print legendaries that are that good in, like, neutral slots.
I'm also just thinking...
Alex and Ysera.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm also just thinking, like, do they not want legendaries to actually mean a bit more, you know what I mean? Like, okay, Rag, you just play this card on 8, and whatever happens, happens. Do they not want legendaries that actually have a greater impact on the game, but in a different way, you know what I mean? Like, you really open up...
Word.
Exactly, like, there's so much more diversity that, I don't know. The game just gets more interesting as well.
Yeah, maybe.
Well...
I think one of the biggest misses, though, that we've forgotten about with the rotation is Major Domo. Now, that's the miss that I'm really gonna miss from the rotation, man. I want to see all those... Like, no Major Domo in Standard means that when you play Medivh and then you play that reduced Pyroblast or reduced Kazuka spell, you can't get Major Domo and lose the game anymore because of that.
Oh, damn it.
And that's just, a pity for people like Trollden and content creators.
But in terms of that, I'm sure there will be enough new cards... Like, that will create enough content. Blizzard seems to love creating cards, like, specifically with memes in mind.
Yeah.
You know, what's his name?
Man, Noggin Foggin.
Oh, God. Like, I opened that card. It's so awful. What?
Did you see the Trollden video where he made an OTK deck with it, but he uses, what's that? The weapon that has a 50% chance of missing.
So I did see that. It. Yeah,
right, I got one more.
With the idea that he pumps his weapon. And then, it's Fool's Bane.
It's Fool's Bane. He doesn't have Fool's Bane. He just smacks face.
Yeah.
Retarded.
Yeah, I thought that would be the combo there. Yeah, that's pretty stupid. That's not the kind of combo deck I enjoy playing.
Oh, isn't it?
No.
You're not the meme type, dude.
I'm tempted. I have almost... I was almost playing the Ginny Priest OTK deck. But then I was like, no, I don't want to lose 4 billion ranks.
Oh, but now with the new rank floors, you won't have to worry about that.
Yeah, I can just...
How bad is Mere Noggin Fogger, actually? Like, realistically, how bad is Mere Noggin Fogger?
Bad.
What does it die to? AoE? No, it only dies to AoE. Just think about that. It only dies to AoE.
Yeah, sure. It's fun. It's one of the most amusing cards, yeah.
So what are you saying? But if you play it on, like, a board and the first thing hits... So let's say you play it on a board you're behind on. It's a much more likely that any minion they trade is going to trade into it. So for those who don't know, Mayan Fogger is a 9 mana 5/4, and its text reads, all targets are chosen randomly. So the thing is, if you only have two options, so if you're only presenting them your face and Mayan Noggin Fogger, and they have three minions that they need to either, like, let's say two attack minions and one 4 attack minion, and you're on, like, three, right? So they attack with the 4 attack minion first, and then the target is chosen randomly. Or, like, let's say they have a fireball or something, and then...
Remember, it can go to their face as well, yeah?
True. Oh, right. Okay, can minions attack each other?
Yeah, minions can attack each
exactly.
other.
Yeah, exactly. That's all the whole thing. The minions can attack.
I didn't think that those were considered valid targets at all, to be honest.
It is, yeah. That's what makes the card
Oh
ridiculous.
god. That okay, that's really
It
stupid.
makes it really sick.
Yeah, see,
So
it's not
that's
as simple
become
as just like, yeah, the card's terrible. A little bit more to it.
well, yeah. Things that kill that target random enemy things are good, right? Like deadly shots,
Guys, I'm
but
busy defending me and Noggenfugger. How does
anyway, yeah, I think
that
we've fallen way off the like the bandwagon of
Okay.
like reasonable discussion here, to be honest.
Okay.
Anyway, so what else did they announce here? They announced, yeah, so Conceal, I think that Miracle Rogues are still going to be viable afterwards.
Really?
Yeah, because I just don't think that they'll be viable in the same way. Sometimes you do just, they'll be like a lot slower, right? You'll kind of want to do your gadgets and turns in the same turn. And I'm also quite glad they didn't move gadgets and because I was quite enjoying gadgets and in a freeze mage version that I was playing and also mostly in druid where it's actually decent, right? Like if they moved it would have definitely nerfed the Jade Idol a lot, but
It's the
yeah.
whole they want to they don't want they want the game to be more interactive. So the whole thing is obviously by you going auctioneer, conceal, you know, very fun, very interactive, you know, fun for everybody, you know, all around. But it's the same thing. I think it's the same reasoning why I don't mind them doing what they did to Power Overwhelming as well. Yeah, the fact that
Oh yeah,
you
we
would then
totally.
Yeah, I can be forgetting about it all.
Yeah, but when
like
you.
I'm instead of
Yeah.
Leroy, because I think they could have
Yeah.
easily instead they could have left Power Overwhelming and moved Leroy.
And move Leroy,
But
yeah.
I don't know. I just think Power Overwhelming is too good in like both Zoo
And Reno Rock.
and Reno decks because of Shadow Flame. Even if there was
And
no
also, it's so
Leroy.
good at Sylvanas.
Yeah.
So good at Sylvanas as
Well, I
well.
mean, yeah, okay. But even if we assume they're moving Sylvanas out and they're not
Oh,
touching
right.
Shadow
Right.
Flame,
Yeah.
right? Then Power Overwhelming is still really good with that. And so I think Power Overwhelming is just a lot more versatile a card than Reno. And also, I still want to play Reno Shadow Step Reno because I've been enjoying doing
You
that with
mean
aggro, right?
Leroy?
I mean, yeah,
You mean Leroy?
Leroy, bleh. Yeah, Leroy.
Yeah, and I think Leroy is still in the fact. Obviously, it's neutral. It still gives you know aggro decks that you know that finisher. So
Yeah.
as much you know, I think it's still. That's why I think Power Overwhelming is fine. Same with Ice Lance. You know, you want to diversify the format. You want maybe people to experiment with different variants, like a little bit,
Yeah,
because now
new
Freeze
mage
Mage.
decks are coming, right?
Yeah, because also I mean Freeze Mage might still be a thing, but you have to now rely on actually. Do you run what's it? The Evolve Kobold to try and get that extra damage because now you don't
Well,
have
this is like,
the.
how long is
Well,
Freeze
with
Mage
no
going to play?
Thoracine is a problem as well.
Since the game was officially released, it was a thing.
Yeah,
Yeah, well,
Freeze Mage has
beta,
been
yeah.
I'm
around for
talking
ages.
like I think it was like closed beta, yeah.
Yeah.
Like just after I started, it was just
What?
after that nerf. They
Pyroblast.
nerfed like all the Freeze Mage cards. But yeah, Pyroblast used to cost 8 mana. Cone of Cold was like 3 mana. And
Yeah.
Blizzard was like
And
five mana.
Frost Nova was like two, wasn't it?
I think so. I think everything was literally where I cost one or two layers, and then they're like, Freeze Mage was. Oh, and that was also back in the day when Alexstrasza got rid of armor.
Yeah.
Did Alexstrasza used to get rid of armor?
So basically, oh, Warrior, you've
Wow.
got however much armor, okay, Alexstrasza, and you're on 50.
Wow. That's hectic.
Yeah,
I didn't
back in
even
the day.
realize. I didn't know that that was a thing.
It was before. Yeah, it was before I started playing. I remember reading stories.
Dale remembers.
I remember.
Okay.
What was the okay.
So one of the other things that we briefly mentioned previously is that they're moving to 130 card expansions now. What are your thoughts on that? Let's see what Zaymok has to say first. Oh, okay. But apparently not. Let's see what Pandemonia has to say about the 130 card expansion change first.
As much as I like the whole new content, and they said they're going to add sort of the adventure style boss fights as part of the expansions for free, the thing I feel the problem is, you know, if their creative team isn't, you know, they're going to start running out of, like, in terms of ideas and mechanics, and then it's going to reach a point where it's going to get stale a bit too quickly. So I think they have to be very careful in terms of, especially they want to release 130 new cards each time. They've got to be very careful, you know, how quickly they give people new and shiny toys before they're eventually going to go where 2, 3 years down the line, you're seeing a card that's basically like Lotheb, but it's, you know, 3 mana instead. You know, it's just
Yeah.
versions of previous cards. You know, especially a card game, you know, how many different varieties of cards, you know, it reaches a point where your creativity is a, you know, the creativity is a major limiting factor.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it should be okay. 130 cards is not, I don't think is too much of an ask, to be honest. Like, or let's say 390, let's say 400 cards. 400 cards I don't think is too much of an ask. Considering that, to be honest, they print a lot of like meme cards like Amgam Rager and Ice Rager, which are relevant to us. Yeah. So, or cards that sort of tell a story but aren't necessarily that good, right? So I think, like, let's say, even if we were getting 100 decent cards in a set, like, I think that would be a lot. I don't think that it's too much of an issue. I also think that it's difficult. We always think, like, ooh, they've used up all the mechanics. But then sometimes the Blizzard do come along with things like Discover, which is a really fun mechanic. You know, and I'm a big fan of Discover, even though it makes my life hell sometimes. And now they've got the, like, cross-class Discover thing going on. And they might also be able to expand a bit on like some of the existing themes like that, like the cross-class stuff, and also the C'Thun kind of or the old gods stuff, right? So they might be able to print some more stuff to synergize with N'Zoth or C'Thun, or, you know, hopefully not Yogg, maybe Yashiraj, the completely forgotten
one. How much room is there for new mechanics? Like, what kind of stuff could they do?
I don't know. I mean, that's it's like asking, you know, how can any painter paint anything new? Everything's been painted. You're like, no, I'm sure somebody can paint. You know, it's like how can anybody write a new book? Like, it's a creative thing, right? So we have to trust them. I think that this game is nowhere near that old that we really have to worry about. I mean, if you look at other card games like Magic or Yu-Gi-Oh! Or Pokemon, they've been going for so long and they're still managing to print new things. So, like, I don't think that's too much of a concern for Hearthstone.
No, I think they'll definitely, yeah, there'll be enough mechanics. Just comes down to, you know, how soon, at what point are they going to realize, you know, some mechanics they might need to bring back. Like, for example, a card, you know, that I was hoping they'd move to Classic, but is a card like Lotheb. You know, it's a card that, you know, you'd like to...
It's just too good as a 5/5, though, because it's a 5-mana 5/5 that can't be removed. Like, how do you remove it?
Okay, but, like, what I'm saying is that effect is, you know...
Yeah.
I would have liked to see Lotheb obviously move to Classic, but obviously... future, what you could do is, let's say, print a 2-mana one that increases, you know, but what I'm saying is a similar sort of similar effect but different numbers, if that makes sense.
Yeah, well, that's one of the advantages of Wild, is like it gives you an opportunity to have these like reprints, right, of like older cards but like a new take on them.
Yeah, like I mean, we already see them do that, like with the red Swamp Ooze that they printed in this set and the red Mana Worm. I mean, they're essentially just bigger versions of the previous like copies, right? And so, like, I mean, those are cards that are still in standard.
Red Swamp Ooze.
Well, it is. There's like a red Swamp Ooze. A red acidic ooze or whatever. Toxic, yeah,
combination
whatever.
Of Swamp Ooze. It's a combination of acidic Swamp Ooze and Bloodsail Corsair, really.
Yeah, which is just worse. But anyway, that is one thing I would like to see them do, is more ways to interact with weapons. So, like, one of the ideas I was thinking of is having, like, an Eldor effect for weapons. So where you could actually reduce a weapon's attack rather than just removing it, right? Or something
that'd be really cool, actually, yeah.
Something like that, where you can like make a, like debuff a weapon in some way. So make it so that like give a opponent's weapons a cursed blade effect or something like that. You know, that would be great for combo decks.
You could say
let's say you gave them a cursed blade effect only on their turn. Like that's a reasonable way to
that's
do it.
That's
pretty
right? Cool.
So that discourages them from using the weapon for anything but face. So that's discouraging them from like using the weapon to interact with board.
Like Gorehowl.
Yeah. So like using it on Gorehowl essentially is saying, cool, you can have as much damage as Gorehowl has left to my face. Because really, do you want to take double damage? Unless you're so far ahead, that's probably not going to happen. So yeah, I think that's an interesting design space that I don't think they've explored that much, that I would really like to see them explore. Because like, I think one of the biggest problems at the moment we've seen is that all the weapon classes are actually just too strong. Except Hunter, because they don't have any good weapons, really.
I mean, Eagle one's good, but they just don't have
weapon.
Yeah, it's just too slow, Eagle.
What would be your feeling about introducing, let's say, obviously if you've done line, a new sort of card type, so you know, because not all classes have weapons and not all classes have secrets, you know, to try and balance. So let's take example of a class like Druid. They don't have weapons really, you know, they don't have secrets, why not give them a specific card type?
Yeah, but Druid has a whole like ramp thing, right? Like innovate, wild growth, like that's pretty stupid. That's why Druid
But let's say having like a, but like that's also why I like the medieval weapon, in that that is in a sense not a weapon. You know, I mean, yes, you can use it as a weapon, but realistically, it's like an enchantment,
it's
like almost.
Is it
a
That's an artifact. Isn't that what it's called?
It depends on the effect.
And, like, yeah.
I mean, I think we could easily see like aura effects, you know, like play, like start playing a role. You know, where you could almost you play a card that turns the whole battlefield.
Aura is awesome, weird. Aura is an awesome, weird. Like, Saucy Captain heals minions. Do you know that?
Yeah. Well, those are cards that essentially have auras. So I mean, they could. So I think the way that they've spaced their board and stuff makes it a little bit restrictive. You'd have to essentially print it as like an immune minion, maybe like an immune minion with stealth is kind of the way to give like an aura effect, and then it only dies to AoE. Well, then it doesn't even die to AoE. I don't know. You've got to have ways to interact with it then, right? But I definitely think that there is design space for them to print some things like that. I do really like what they did with Medivh and his weapon. And that it's essentially like a way of working around that limitation. But it looks like Zaymok is going to have to leave us a bit early. So that's just going to leave Pandemonia and I for the rest of this stream. But we've still got quite a bit to discuss, so we'll keep going. Cheers, Zaymok. Thanks a lot for joining us. Give him a follow on Twitter, at Peaceful Dinks. And I don't know if you want to say anything else, Zaymok.
No, not really. I don't know, how often are we going to be doing this? Like, is it going to be a regular thing?
Yeah, hopefully a regular thing. Just follow me on Twitter and you'll find out when we're going to be doing it.
I need the followers.
Yeah. And follow me on Twitch. Yeah. That helps too. That one's down there.
Well, cool. Cheers, guys.
Cheers. Shameless marketing. Cheers.
13-year-old's got to go to sleep. Guys, people better not think I am actually Dundin. Cheers.
Okay, anyway, cheers, Zaymok. Okay, so I just need to fix... Actually, this will work for the overlay. It's just a bit weird spacing at the moment. Anyway, so... so the 130-card expansions, personally, I'm a big fan of that. I think it gives them more design space, and I always felt like adventures didn't really affect the meta enough. So as a competitive player, I'm pretty happy that when they release cards, they're going to be impacting the meta a lot more.
Yeah, I like the more variety, definitely. I mean, because of the adventures, what you only got 30 30 and 40 cards a lot of times, and then you got half of them which were absolute crap.
So
I definitely like the fact that, you know, we have more shiny toys, but it's always a case of then how quickly does new shiny toys last.
So we have the next big deck. Yeah, hopefully we should see some more like interesting new toys. But I mean, I'm pretty happy to see the changes that they're making to the way Hearthstone's gonna work in terms of like the expansion stuff. They've also talked about moving some other cards to the Hall of Fame, like Molten Giant. I know you were a big Handlock player, so
What they actually wanted to do, sorry, just to clarify, they actually wanted to basically unnerf Molten Giant, but move it to Hall of Fame. So they wanted to sort of do because currently in its current form it's pretty bad because you're nearly dead most of the times.
That's more specifically what they were meaning, or what I was meaning with that. That we could see the return of like Handlock and Wild. And speaking of, Wild is actually something they've definitely said, like they've indicated that they want to support some more. One of the other things they announced is that there's going to be a heroic brawl coming out after the new expansion when the cards rotate. So a wild based heroic brawl. I'm excited because I can still play Freeze Mage in the brawl. So.
I could play Sludge Vulture, Zombie Char.
I think it's a little punishing for a lot of more casual players that disenchanted a lot of their cards going to Wild because they were like, oh, I'm never going to play it. Which I think is actually just going to make the brawl even harder, right? Because it's only going to be like the hoarders that kept their cards, or the pay to wins, or the people that have been playing for so long that they don't really need the cards. They didn't really need to disenchant the cards. So
it's essentially the legacy, you know, going back to Magic analogies, it's basically the legacy of it. So obviously when a new player starts, you're not going to suggest they start playing Wild. You know, obviously you're going to start by playing players disenchant cards that only are good in wild, and then only when you've been playing for, let's say, a long time, and you're quite heavily invested in the game, then you go, okay, I've got these cards, and now they've rotated, okay, I can now start playing wild.
Yeah.
And the nice thing about wild is, you know, you'll never have, like, the nice thing about it is, you might have OP decks, but because all of them are OP, it's kind of okay and it's kind of balanced. It's like giving the whole world nukes, you know. It's kind of okay.
Well, let's not go into that discussion on nuclear arms races, but I think it could be interesting. Yeah, I think that they're going to need to maybe balance wild a bit more, and maybe that's why they were considering this like idea of unnerfing Molten Giant. Apparently, we're probably only likely to see that in 2018. But you know, it's difficult, I think, for them to balance wild without like changing the cards that they're moving to wild, or you know, changing the existing cards, like buffing or unnerfing cards. Essentially, the only way, because they're not releasing cards directly to wild anymore, you know. So I think what we're going to see is probably something similar to what happened in Magic as well, where the format's kind of forgotten and it becomes super OP for a while, and then maybe they start paying more attention to it, like with what Wizards did with Modern, essentially.
The problem is, the issues you bring up, it's very difficult to balance, like, Wild, Standard, and not to mention, you still got Arena to worry about.
Yeah.
In terms of trying to make sure they all exist happily in their own ecosystem, because no matter how good you are at balancing, you're going to end up in a situation where, okay, you think you've got Standard down perfectly, but oh dear, you know, Arena's broken now because, you know, something's at a common, you know, and you can't...
Lost Crystal Potion.
And or, what's it, Firelands Portal is a common, and, you know, it's too good in Arena. So it's a constant balancing act, I think, for them. And I think they're still learning, you know, because, I mean, like, Magic, they've had over 20 years to learn these lessons, whereas... I mean, Hearthstone, what, 4 years now? Three and a half years now?
Personally, I'm interested to see what they're going to do in terms of, including Wild into the competitive scene. I mean, they've kind of vaguely hinted at that, but I'd be interested to see if there was, like, HCT point rewards or something for playing Wild. You know, I think that would encourage a lot of...
Yeah.
And how they would work that. Would they maybe run Wild simultaneous to Standard? I think that would probably be a bit much for now. But we could see something like in other card games where you have sort of multi-format. So you have like, often in other formats, it's like sealed formats, you know, like Arena in Hearthstone context. Or with, you know, constructed formats. So yeah, personally, I would really like
that
to see
that. That would actually be a really good idea. You know, you have a tournament of like 5 rounds Standard, you know, 5 rounds... Wild, and then 5 rounds Arena or something. So, like, actually, multi-format tournaments could actually be really interesting and exciting.
I mean, they would definitely have to do a lot more to make Arena sort of competitive in that format. Obviously, they have to have client support for having more than two copies of a card in your deck, and like those kind of things, you know, like exporting Arena decks. So I think one of the biggest things that is maybe a bit hidden here, but maybe I'm just reading between the lines because it's what I want. But I feel like they might actually be making more client changes. So actually improving the game, maybe with stuff like the long fabled tournament mode that we all want now that we have deck slots, or you know, stuff to help Arena in ways like this. Because they don't have to focus so much on all this adventure content, which from a developer perspective, like I know that that's something that's very time consuming to do. You know, whereas creating new cards isn't quite as time consuming. There's a lot of testing, obviously, with mechanics and stuff. And then, you know, they should just hire Disguised Toast to do that, quite frankly. He breaks everything and then they fix it. But
within the first week, he's broken the game in like 30 different ways.
Yeah.
And, you know, in ways you never thought were possible.
Yeah, so I think, you know... It's something that maybe I'm just being a little bit hopeful for, but that's something I'm really hoping that might happen, you know, might be more client changes. I really want to see... They have spoken a little bit about client changes to support Tavern Hero tournaments and, like, those kind of tournaments, you know, like the Fireside Gatherings. So hopefully that means maybe there'll be some kind of client changes that'll facilitate tournaments.
Tournament mode is something and because I mean I speak, you know, I've spoken to quite a lot of different people, and especially like the thing is for some of the casual players trying to head into competitive, you know, the whole thing for many tournaments where you have to take a bazillion screenshots and you have to open your friends list, and you know, and you can only have one deck open of a class, you know, you can only have one class, I mean one deck of a class. It's for a lot of players, and I mean even personally, it's really tedious and it's quite frustrating, you know, especially where, you know, a lot of classes have multiple viable decks, you know, and on ladder you don't want to, you know, it's constantly annoying having to go, okay, change, you know, between aggro and midrange, or between control and midrange.
Yeah, and so, I think it also makes it quite difficult for a lot of tournament organizers, because you have to have the third-party support for, like, pick-ban stuff. And we see a lot of third-party websites, which personally, because I've been doing a lot of HCT Cup grinding recently, I've become familiar with a lot of them. And a lot of them have their, like, flaws, right? So, like, Battlefy, for instance, you can see your opponent's decks from their other games before you play yours. So you could have four classes, which you stuck with, but you can change in those four classes. And that's kind of like not really how it's supposed to be done. And then in other ones, sometimes on like some websites like Match Arena, they'll say that you have to like, you do this weird pick, ban, and chat format, and that's the worst. Because if you're not picking simultaneously, somebody always has an advantage. Because you know, you can just have all nine open and then you pick your last one if you got the last pick, and then you're like, cool. And Match Arena is even weirder in that you ban first. So you ban without even knowing what they're going to pick. So you ban and then they just can't pick that. It's like, what? That's super weird.
So again, so what, you can ban Warrior, and even if they were ever going to pick Warrior.
Yeah. Then they have to pick three other classes. Yeah. But anyway, that's a whole different... topic. But, I think, I mean, you know, there's a lot of this stuff that's not...
Though, I think.
Yeah, there's a lot of the stuff that's just not standardized, basically. So it would be nice to see Blizzard sort of standardizing it in some way. Although a lot of it is really difficult, and a lot of it is a really big UI concern that I do kind of sympathize with them on that, you know. Having to design a UI across multiple platforms is a really tricky thing. So I can kind of understand, you know, that that's a bit of a problem for them. But obviously, it would be super useful to players like us that really want to see, you know, really want to, like, be pushing in tournaments.
Yeah, because especially, I mean, I don't know, you're obviously more in tune with the whole coding and programming aspect. But surely it's not that difficult to introduce some sort of almost, you know, the whole thing of you lock decks in. So even if I have, you know, three mage decks, you know, there's an option that surely even user interface wise, where I go click, 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 lock these four decks into the tournament, and you know, the client knows, you know, my opponent knows, and that information is, you know, shared. That okay, you know, he's locked these decks in. Obviously, you don't know the contents of the deck, but you know that it's only that deck that can be used. Because obviously, the reason why people, you know, we have to take screenshots, it's because always there's a risk of, you know, somebody can prepare five, let's say five Pirate Warrior decks, each slightly ticked for different matchups.
Yeah.
And then, you know, even though they win, you know, you end up switching to one which has a Acidic Swamp boost, or you switch one to, which is a little bit tuned differently.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas if you can just, I'm sure that there must be some sort of auditing mechanism.
Yeah, sure, but like I think the thing is that they don't want to sort of half-ass it, and that kind of feels like a half-ass solution, really only just allowing decks locking. Obviously, from our perspective, we're like, oh, that's better than nothing, but, you know, a lot of the problem with screenshots is also just recording wins and losses. So, like, if you have a dispute online, because in a lot of online tournaments, you don't necessarily know your opponent, so you could easily have a dispute. So there's also just the pain of taking screenshots after games. You know, I play a lot of these HCT Cups, and I haven't once had a problem where I've actually had a dispute. Most people are pretty nice in the Hearthstone scene, but it's always a problem. Yeah, I mean, I always still have to take screenshots. And some tournament websites...
High stakes.
Yeah, and some tournament websites in particular, like, force you to upload screenshots. So sometimes if you forget to take one for a game, you just upload a random screenshot, because that's all you can do. Like, oh, they won't allow you to report the score if you don't upload a screenshot. So, yeah, I mean, obviously, I would like to see a lot of the support. You know, also just for, like, tournament brackets and those kind of things. That is, I think, one of the most difficult things. Tournament lobbies, tournament brackets, those are really difficult from a UI perspective. And I would definitely like to see those as well.
Like a summary screenshot. So even if you do take a screenshot or something, you know, at the end of, let's say, a best of, that you can state you're going to play a friendly best of five, and afterwards, Hearthstone, you know, shows you a nice summary screen You know, your best of five, round one was deck X versus deck Y, result, you know, like all five games.
Well, I mean, if results, it's just a result, they can just maybe show 3-2 or something like that. You know, they don't have to show...
The decks, thanks. So you can take a screenshot of that and, you know, post one screenshot as opposed to 7 million.
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously our problems are a little bit more specific, or at least I think you're talking more from like the DGL perspective. Rather than like you know, like,
a lot of tournaments.
Well, a lot of tournaments don't necessarily require you to upload screenshots. Screenshots are only for dispute, basically, and they won't punish you if you don't upload screenshots. It differs like tournament to tournament depending on the organizers, right? So most of the time, I take screenshots playing European tournaments, and then I never use them. I never have to upload them. The only screenshot that's important is the deck selection one beforehand.
Yeah, because you have to make sure that you have, you know, got multiple decks.
Yeah. Okay. Speaking about tournaments, though, we were going to speak a bit about the prelims. I don't know if you have any overall thoughts you want to say about EU and NA prelims that happened over the last two weekends.
I mean, I managed to watch some of it, and what just struck me is the fact that, you know, you look at all the lineups, and there was so, like, what the the statistics, it was something ridiculous, like 85% of people brought, like, shape, you know. And I mean, you just look at the top lineups. It consists of Aggro Shaman, Pirate Warrior, Reno Mage, and then most of the decks insert either Miracle Rogue or Reno Lock. And I think I've basically covered about 80% of, you know, the deck lineups for both EU and Europe. You know, correct me on the exact numbers, but I think I've summarized.
Yeah.
So you've got some tip. You know.
Yeah, I mean, there was obviously like a very... high prevalence of certain classes, and like even if you look at like Hearthstone top decks summary, they even summarized it based on like a card, like how many times a card appeared in a deck. You know, generally we saw mostly Reno decks and Patches decks, really. So I mean, like at the top eight, and I think in both prelims we saw everyone bringing Shaman, unsurprisingly, because once again Shaman is also just quite versatile. Like beyond just aggro Shaman being strong, there was a fair bit of mid range Shaman as well. And we saw like everyone, almost everyone bringing Mage in both. We saw, I think, in NA a lot, there was a big shift towards Tempo Mage, which proved very unsuccessful. Only Amnesiac making top 8 with Tempo Mage, and he didn't make top 4 in the end. So no trip to Bahamas for Young Savage. that's what he calls himself. If you watch the stuff, anyway. So, I don't know. I think there was a fair bit of variety, actually, in some of the decks. I mean, we even saw Reno Priest making top 8 in NA.
Three classes are auto.
Yeah, I don't know. I think depending on lineup, I think there's like five classes that are just too much stronger than the rest, right? Rogue, Shaman, Warlock, and Warrior. Rogue, Shaman, Warlock, Warrior, and Mage. Those are kind of the five classes. And sometimes you might play Druid in certain lineups if you want to like target Reno Mage.
Yeah, you're breaking up there.
I was saying, sorry. Sometimes you might want to play Druid to target Reno Mage, or you might want to play Priest to target control decks, and you almost never play Hunter or Paladin because they're bad. Somebody I know, Phenom, was playing a control paladin. I think he had an Zothin, and it was basically just like a concede paladin. at NA prelims. I think he played Muzzy in one of the early rounds, which didn't help because Muzzy was playing all the aggro decks. I don't know what his overall record is, but yeah, I mean, there were some people bringing interesting decks. And I mean, it's not like he was messing around. I think he was legitimately hoping, that it was going to work. You know, he was going for some off-the-wall strategy. I think a bit sick of the meta as well, but anyway. So I don't know. I think overall we did kind of see like the best... Hello? I think your connection is dying a bit there because you're kind of disappearing a bit for me. But anyway, I think overall we did kind of see the best decks prevailing a bit. I think one of the overarching things I would draw from both prelims is that Reno Mage is a little bit too strong, to be honest. I think that Reno Mage is really good in a lot of the matchups, and even some of the lineups that were targeting it never got anywhere, right? So that kind of tells you. I mean, even though in NA we saw once again a lot of Tempo Mages, the Tempo Mages just fell short compared to Reno Mage. I mean, I would honestly rather play the aggro lineup with Reno Mage than with Tempo Mage. That's like how bad I think Tempo Mage is at times.
Runo Mages is still comes down to versatility. And even though, you know, Reno Mage is Reno Mage, the amount of ways you can build it allows you that amount of flexibility that, you know, playing a lot of the other decks, you don't have those, you know, what they refer to as flexi slots a lot of times, you know.
Yeah.
I think Pirate Warrior, the guys joke that there's literally like, you know, 2 to 4 flexi slots. And even of those slots, a lot of them have kind of agreed which cards are more or less the best to run in those plays, in those slots.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, overall, I think I was very happy with the players that came through the top four from EU. I think it's a really strong field from Europe. And, I mean, considering we both play on the European server, I think we're probably both a little bit biased towards Europe, right? I mean, like, personally, yeah, I would like Europe to win. It makes me feel better, even though we're South African. It's kind of like, oh, at least if Europe wins, that means the server I'm playing on is the better one, right? And, like, you know, sometimes you play... Yeah, sometimes you play the... And also, yeah, it's not America. But yeah, I mean, I was really happy to see like Frozen make it from NA and Dr. Jinkininki, I think that's how you pronounce his name. I have no idea. Yeah, the unpronounceable name. Yeah. So I think he was also like quite a standout player. He played really well and definitely deserved to take home the championship there for NA. I think NA's top four overall is a bit weaker, but I think Frozen and Dr. Jinkininki are definitely two standout players from there. So, yeah, I don't know if you have anything else you want to say on the prelims.
I would, in terms of prelims, I would like lineups to be a little bit more diverse. You know, it was, for me, it was the same sort of thing with the World Champs last year, you know, where, you know, everybody bought Shaman, where a lot of the lineups became so sort of stagnant. You know, I would like to see back, you know, the good old days where, you know, you could have different assortments of different lineups and they were all viable.
So I think the thing with that is that having a format like Swiss, which personally that's one thing I'm a huge fan of them changing to, what kind of tends to happen, and we see it in a lot in other card games as well, is that the decks that are the best to bring to a tournament, even if they're not necessarily the most prevalent decks in the whole field, they will rise to the top. So often in your top eights, you will see a lot of like the same decks. I mean, we've seen it in like Magic and other games recently as well, is that you will sometimes get the same lineups or decks in those other games kind of rising to the top because they were actually just the correct meta picks, right? So I think that in NA we did see a variation more, maybe not so much in classes, but a variation in the archetypes within those classes. And I think that, you know, formats like Swiss and these big tournaments with a lot of top players, they will kind of sometimes tend to have the top lineups coming towards the top. So, you know, in the top like 8 or top 4, you might see a lot of similar lineups because, to be honest, those were the correct lineups to bring. And I think, you know, that's one of the big skills in Hearthstone that gets overlooked a lot, and that's lineup building. I mean, we saw a lot of top players that didn't make it because they just got the lineups wrong.
Yes, you make a point. But when the whole field, you know, top 8, top 4, you will see similar lists because those are obviously the guys who work together and who've made, like you say, made the correct lineup pick. But when I'm talking of everybody is bringing similar lineups, that's when I feel the
problem.
Well,
I don't think necessarily...
Where there's almost... There's a consensus as to what the, you know, there's almost no doubt that, okay, bring Shaman, you know, I mean,
yeah.
I
think there was, once again, not much doubt in a lot of the classes that were going to be brought, and it was a case of, like, how do you pick your four decks from these, you know, five classes, pretty much, and so I think that that's obviously not great when there are supposed to be 9 classes in,
you see, that's my point.
Yeah. But I think within those classes there was a bit of variation, which is at least nice to see. I don't think it's quite as bad as a lot of people make it out to be, but hopefully the nerfs that we spoke about earlier will have an impact to bring some of those slightly more forgotten classes back to the fore.
Cough, cough. Hunter.
Yeah. I just find it funny that everyone's crying for, like, Hunter to come back, and, like, everyone's wants Hunter now, and you're like... Okay, but like a year ago and ever since pretty much like release, everyone's hated Hunter because it's been like this face deck and then Undertaker Hunter and then like the Sunshine mid-range Hunters were too strong, and then Face Hunter was a thing again, and everyone's hated Hunter for, like, all this time, and now everyone's like, oh, no, Hunter's so awesome, please bring back Hunter, and I'm like, what?
It's the same with Paladin. It's like, you know, I think people have forgotten that not too long ago, you know, Paladin was the cancer. You know,
shielded
Paladin
mini-bot into Muster for battle.
You forgot to...
Well, I mean, I'm not even talking about the secret Paladin, but...
Yeah, no, I'm talking, yeah, turn one Secret Keeper, turn two mini bot or knife juggler, turn three Master for Battle.
I don't know, just mini bot Master for Juggler. I mean Master for Juggler. Yeah, Master for Battle is just it's just too strong. I mean, that combo with that curve was just ridiculous in that deck, you know, especially when the days when they had piloted Shredder and stuff as well. But anyway, you are kind of showing just how long you've been playing this game. And on that topic, you recently reached 10,000 ranked wins. So congrats for that. How does it feel to have such a nice round number, which you have inevitably destroyed by now?
I haven't actually played much ranked. You know, I've been playing some other games. Unfortunately, spoiler, like I was, you know, post on Facebook, spoiler alert, you get absolutely nothing for 10,000 ranked wins.
Just a sweet screenshot if you don't miss that exact number.
Yeah, exactly. I know Martin, Skunksy, he missed it by like a couple hundreds.
Oh.
Because he used it a while ago. But then it's also a case of 10,000, it's a lot. I'll be playing for quite a long time. I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's definitely...
Not any different to 4,000 ranked wins.
Sure. I mean, it's definitely a notable achievement, though. And it does show, like, just how long you've been playing this game. Yeah.
Yeah. And how long I've been try-harding for.
Yeah. Anyway, I think that's all we have. If anyone has any questions for... any of us, I'm not 100% sure who will be on the panel next week, but if anyone has any questions, you can hit me up on Twitter or post on Facebook and just tag me if it's the South African Facebook group. But yeah, I don't know if there's anything else you want to say, Pandemonia, before we're done for the night.
I think we've talked a fair amount. Probably a bit too much as usual. I could talk about Hearthstone for like ever.
Yeah, we can definitely go on for much longer, but I think at an hour and 15 minutes about this is enough. Do you want to give any shout outs or anything like that? Or plug your Twitter or whatever?
Yeah, well, my Twitter's there. I do have a Facebook page, you know, Pandemonia. I have a Facebook fan page, you know.
Yeah, I don't even have one of those, man.
Yeah. When I got signed, you know, it's like gotta start being all pro and things.
Yeah.
Gotta try.
Yeah, but do they force you to have an Instagram account though? That's when you know you're really on that social media game. It's when you've got that Instagram account
Instagram.
Just like Instagram screenshots of Hearthstone. That actually sounds like a good idea now. Maybe I'm gonna do that.
But Instagram salt. Instagram being salty.
Oh, yeah, just Instagram selfie reactions when people play Dirty Rat on 2.
And put a leave like, oh, Dirty Rat.
No. Don't worry, I'm going to do a whole different video ranting about Dirty Rat. That's a whole other story.
That's going to trigger me. Please stop. But yeah.
Anyway, thanks a lot for joining us and sticking around a bit longer than Zaymok could. please let us know any thoughts you have on the YouTube video in the comments section, or like or share or do all those things. That's going to help us grow and actually know whether we need to be making more of these or whether everyone hates it, which is hopefully not the case. Cool. Thanks a lot, everyone. Cheers.